Is a session, online session on basic electrical engineering, unit 1 introduction, lecture 1. And as you know, I am Shravan Kumar, associate professor, department of EC, Shreyas Institute of Engineering and Technology. And you can have my contact number and email ID. Let's have a quick look at your syllabus. It's basic electrical engineering. You have unit 1 as DC circuits, AC circuits second unit, and transformers is your third unit, electrical machines unit 4, and unit 5 as electrical installations. In unit 1, we have almost covered the fundamentals like what is charge, potential, power, Ohm's law, KVL and KCL, mesh and nodal analysis, source transformation, star delta transformation, different theorems, statements along with some problems, and time domain analysis of RL and RC circuits. Coming to the second unit, we have seen what is a sinusoidal waveform, its importance, representation of a sinusoidal waveform, peak and RMS values, form factor and crest factor, peak factor and form factor, nothing but power and types of powers, and single phase AC analysis of RL RC circuits, RLC circuit as well. And we have also seen what is three phase balanced circuit and resonance, a series resonant circuit, its bandwidth derivation, also its resonant frequency derivation, and some problems based on them. And coming to unit 3, we have discussed what is a transformer, what are the different types of transformers, what is an ideal transformer and practical transformer with and without loads, and we have also seen what different phasor diagrams corresponding to them. Now, before starting the actual syllabus, because it's been a while we have been in touch with the subject, almost 15 days or so, so I just want to have a recap of all the things that we have covered, just a small revision, so that you'll get familiar with the topics that we have already covered. In a session or two, we'll do that, and then we'll continue our syllabus. Now, electrical charge. Let's start from the fundamentals. What is an electric charge? The charge is the electrical property of the atomic particles. It is denoted by actually Q, and units are Coulomb. Coulomb is a French military engineer. On his honor, it's named as Coulomb. The unit of charge is named as Coulomb. And 1 Coulomb is total charge possessed by 6.25 into 10 power 18 electrons. That is, a single electron has a charge of 1.6 into 10 power minus 19 Coulombs. That is, the total charge for a given number of electrons is given by number of electrons by 6.25 into 10 power 18 electrons. Now, let's see what is electric current. Electric current is the amount of charge per unit time that passes through the surface that is perpendicular to the motion of the charges. It is denoted by I, and units are ampere. It's always a capital A, not small a. So as you can see from the figure, the charges are moving perpendicular to the surface. Moment of free electrons is given, that is free electrons is in case of a conductor. And you can see I is a representation of a current, which is Q by T. The rate of flow of charge carriers can also write as dq by dt. 1 coulomb per second equals to, let's take an example of current. 5 coulomb of charges flow past a given point in a wire in 2 seconds. How many amperes of current is flowing? That is, time is given as 2 seconds and charge is 5 coulombs. You can say current I is equal to q by t, it's 2.5 amperes. Let's see what is electrical voltage. The force motivating electrons to flow in a circuit is called voltage or potential difference. It is the difference in potential energy of the two charges. It is denoted by V, and the unit of potential is volts. And voltage is expressed as, we have also seen an definition for this. It is a work done in moving a charge from infinity to a desired location, or from higher potential to the lower potential. That is, potential is equal to work done per charge, and V is if small change in energy to small change in charge, and unit of voltage is let's take as an example 2 based on voltage. And if 70 joules of energy is available for every 30 coulomb of charge, what is the voltage? Work done is given as 70 joules and charge coulomb 30 coulombs. So that comes out to be V is equal to W by Q, 2.33 volts. Let us see what is power. Power is the rate of flow of energy and is denoted by either P or capital P or small p. Power is equal to work done per time, that is P is equal to dW by dt, but it is also the product of voltage and current. So power is dW by dt or dW by dq into dq by dt. dW by dq is V and dq by dt is I. Power is measured in watts and is denoted by W, as you know. Let's take the example 3 on power. What is the power in watts if energy equals to 50 joules is used in 2.5 seconds? Now work done is given as 50 joules, time as 2.5 seconds. Power is equal to W by T. So 50 by 2.5 is 20 watts. What basically is a circuit? This basic circuit consists of actually three parts. One is the source, other one is load, and the other one is connecting wires. Purpose of a circuit is to transfer energy from source to load. You can transfer energy from source to load. Energy transfer is only possible when the circuit is closed. There are two types. One is the open circuit and the closed circuit. In the next slide, I will also show you an example of that. A circuit in which path of current is interrupted is called as open circuit. That is, there is no flow of charge carriers, is an open circuit. Merely more specific in sense, interconnection of two or more simple elements is called as an electrical network. If a network consists at least one closed path, it is called as a circuit. That is, interconnection of a simple circuit is a network, and if there is at least one closed path, it is a circuit. That's the basic difference between a circuit and a network. Now if you are looking at these two figures, the upper figures, even though the source battery is connected to the load bulb, the switch is open and therefore there is no flow of current or charges, and it is said to be an open circuit. And the second case, the switch is on, the battery is connected to the load lamp. The load can be anything, any appliances that you are using in at your home. So when you are connecting source to load, and whenever there is switch is on, there is a flow of charges or rate of flow of charge carriers current, therefore it is said to be a closed path. Now let's see what is the classification of network elements. Network elements can be broadly classified into four groups. They are active and passive elements, linear and non-linear elements, unilateral and bilateral elements, lumped and distributed. What are active elements? Elements in which can energize the circuit or the other elements, or elements which can supply or which can deliver energy, are called as active elements. The examples are voltage source and current source. So what are passive elements? Elements which consume or store energy are called as passive elements. Like resistor which actually consumes, and capacitor and inductor will store the energy. So all these elements combinedly, elements which are capable of consuming or storing energy, are called as passive elements. And the examples are resistor, inductor and capacitive again. You can see the figures, the circle is actually a voltage source, and diamond shaped is a dependent voltage source, and the arrow mark representation in a circle is a current source, and an arrow mark with a diamond symbol is a dependent current source. And you can see the rest of RLC elements that you already know. What is a unilateral element or what is a bilateral element? A unilateral element is one which offers different impedance in different direction of current flow. That means if you are taking a diode, when it is forward biased, it conducts. That means the resistance of the opposition is very less. And when you interchange the terminals of that, and due to that interchange, the diode does not conduct. That means that there is no there will be a minimum amount of current that's flowing, but it is not as much as it was in the forward bias case. That means the impedance that is being offered by this diode when it is reversed is very high. That means it has different impedances in different directions, which is the best example of an unilateral. But on the other hand, what is a bilateral element? An element which offers same impedance in both the directions. If you're taking resistor, inductor and capacitor elements, even if you connect them by interchanging their terminals, they do offer the same impedance in both the directions. So RLC elements can be taken as an example of bilateral. Linear elements and non-linear elements. Now, what is a linear element? Elements which obey superposition principle or whose VI characteristics are linear, passing through origin is said to be a linear element. Like VI characteristics are a straight line passing through the origin and which satisfy superposition principle, that is principle of homogeneity and additivity. So examples are resistor, capacitor, inductors. And on the other hand, what are non-linear elements? Elements which does not obey superposition principle or whose VI characteristics are not straight line passing through the origin are said to be non-linear elements. You can diode, non-linear resistor, etc. And you can see the VI characteristics there. What are lumped and distributed elements? Lumped elements are those elements which are very small in size and in which simultaneous action takes place for a given cause at a same instant of time. That is, in general, you can say that elements which are not separable from a given circuit are said, which are separable are said to be lumped elements. The examples are resistor, capacitor, and inductors. And on the other hand, distributed elements are those which are not electrically separable. That means, if you're taking a transmission line, the transmission line has the property of a resistor. Because it's not a pure conductor, it has some opposition and it has the property of a resistor. It does not have a resistor in it, but it possesses the property of that resistor. Similarly, it's carrying some current, therefore there is a flux around it and it's acting like an inductor even. And if there are two conductors adjacent to each other, there is a capacitance between them, therefore it also has the property of a capacitance, but you cannot separate them because there are no physical elements present in them, but the properties of these elements are embedded in that transmission line. So these are called as distributed elements. Now, resistance. What is a resistance in general? It's a property of a material to obstruct or limit the flow of current is called as the resistance, and the material is known as the resistor. You can see the symbol of a resistor, and the resistance is directly proportional to the length of the material and inversely proportional to the area of the cross section. R is directly proportional to capital L, where L is the length of the material and it is inversely proportional to 1 by A. A is the area of the cross section of the resistor. So R is equal to rho L by A, where rho is called as the specific resistance or the resistivity of the material. What is specific resistance? It is defined as a measure in which a material strongly opposes the flow of electrical current. The symbol of resistance is R and its unit is ohm. It is actually OHM. And if you look at what is Ohm's law, in general, it is that the current flowing through a conductor is directly proportional to the applied voltage. So I is directly proportional to V, or I is equal to V by R. And what is 1 by R? 1 by R is nothing but G. The inverse property of resistance is conductance. Resistance is opposition to flow of current and conductance is the ability to allow current. So the unit of conductance will be inverse of resistance, that is MHO, mho. We can write the above equation as I is equal to V by R, or V is equal to I into R, or I is dQ by dt, so V is equal to R into dQ by dt. Power, P is equal to V into I, or V is equal to I into R. If you substitute it, you will get I into R into I, that is I square R, or V square by R. I square R is generally used for power loss. Energy lost in resistance in time t is given by W is equal to integral of P dt, that is P into t. And I square R into t, or V square by R into t, is the energy lost. Now let's see what is the equivalent resistance. That is the resistance connected in series and parallel. If you connect n number of resistance in series, what happens and what is the expression that you need to use? And if you have some resistors connected in parallel. What is the equivalent resistance? Now, if there are, let's say, R1, R2, R3 connected in series, that is, one terminal of first resistor is connected to the other terminal of the one terminal of the other resistor. That means they are connected only once, and there is same flow. If at all there is the same current that is flowing through all these resistors, we can say that they are in series. That means even though if sometimes one terminal is connected, the current flowing through them will not be same. So the two conditions that have to be satisfied for two resistors to be in series is they have to be connected only once and the same current. It's not the same amount of the current, but it's the same current flowing in R1 must flow through the R2. Then we can say that these two resistors are in series. Now let's say R1, R2, R3 are connected in series, then the R equivalent is R1 plus R3. Now if let's say R1, R2, R3 are connected in parallel, that means the condition for parallel is both the terminals of two resistors must be connected in, must be connected. That means the two terminals of R1, R2 are connected to R1 are connected to R2, and similarly R2 are connected to R3, or R3 is connected to R1 as well. Now these three resistors are said to be in parallel. The equivalent resistance is the reciprocal of total resistance is equal to the sum of the reciprocal of the individual resistances. When resistors are connected in parallel, equivalent resistance is given by 1 by R equivalent is equal to 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2 plus 1 by R3. Now R equivalent is R1 R2 R3 by R1 R2 plus R2 R3 plus R1 R3. No, you have to remember one thing, that whenever you are connecting resistance in series, the total resistance will increase, and when you are connecting two resistors in parallel, the resistance will decrease. Also, in a series circuit, voltage gets distributed and current remains same, whereas in a parallel circuit, voltage is same constant because they are connected in parallel. Applied voltage will be same for all the resistances, but the current gets distributed. That is, current will be different based on the values of the different resistors. If two resistors of the same value are connected in parallel, then the current in the two both the resistors will be same. So let's problem on the series and parallel resistance. Let's take example 4 as, if let's say R1 is 1 ohm, R2 is 2 ohm, and R3 is 3 ohms. Let's see if they are connected in series, what is the value, and if they are connected in parallel, what is the equivalent resistance. Now when they are connected in series 1, 2, 3, the total resistance will be 1 plus 2 plus 3, that comes out to be 6 ohms, which is the addition of all these three, that is the total resistance in case of a series circuit has increased. Now if you are coming to parallel, if 1 ohm, 2 ohm, 3 ohm are connected in parallel, what is the equivalent resistance? R1, R2, R3 by R1, R2 plus R2, R3 plus R3, R3. You will get the resultant, which is 0.55 ohms, which is pretty much less than all the three values. That means you can say that these resistance in parallel, if the resistors are connected in parallel, the total resistance will get reduced. Now let's have some quiz sort of questions that I just wanted to know whether you have understood what you have learned till now, and it will be good if you have some sort of questions. I'll just quickly read out some 5 to 6 or 10 questions, and I'll also give you the key for this at the end of the session. But just take a pen and piece of paper and just write one, and corresponding to that write the answers for each and every question, and check whether you have written all the questions correctly or not at the end. Let's take first question. A resistor is an example of, whether it's a passive element, active element, or a electrical circuit, or all the above. Just write it down, write an answer for this. For first, write A, B, C, D, any one of these. The second question, current is measured by, you know, or volt or ohm or coulomb or ampere. It's something, but current, it's not current is measured by actually. What is the unit of current? Simple. Now let's take the third question. A 5 ohm resistor has a voltage rating of 100 volts. What is its power rating? You just have to calculate its resistor value is given as 5 and voltage rating as 100. The voltage source is an example of, is it a passive element, active element, electrical circuit? Fifth, what is the unit of resistance? Faraday, Henry, Ohm, all the above. Write the answer corresponding to that. Now, if 20 joule of energy is available for every 20 coulomb of charge, what is the voltage? Work done is given W, and charge is given as 20 coulomb. V is equal to W by Q. We'll get there. Let's see what is that equivalent resistance. Let's see 2 kilo ohm, 3 kilo ohm, 4 kilo ohm, 1 kilo ohm. Kilo is nothing but 1000 ohms. So 2 into 10 cube ohms, 3 into 10 cube ohms, 4 into 10 cube ohms, and 1 into 10 cube. Check whether all these four resistors are connected in series or parallel or series parallel combination and find it out the equivalent resistance across A and B. Maybe probably you may not be able to see this, just check it out. And these are the answers for these questions. If you have answered all the questions well, that's very good and pretty much nice. And if there is something wrong, just you have to go back and check the answers so that you'll have some good basic fundamentals on this. And that's all for now, and we'll also discuss some other topics in the next session, next online session. And thank you so much, and do revise this. I'll also send a PPT of this to everyone and a copy of this as a PDF also if possible. So as of now, that's it. Thank you so much.